As the number of cases declines, India is becoming increasingly concerned about the COVID-19 third wave. Scholars and doctors issued early warnings, all media platforms have extensively covered it, and governments are moving quickly to control the third wave of COVID-19. But we have all completely misunderstood and misinterpreting some crucial aspects of COVID-19. For example, what exactly is a wave, and what does history say about epidemic waves? Why are children safe until now, and how suddenly are they in danger? Using our definition of a wave, is it possible to predict a wave or to contain it? In this video, I like to give some unquestioned answers, and then we crack down on what is required to control COVID-19, or as you might say, waves of COVID-19.
It has already begun in the second wave. Children are being infected in larger numbers. Governments are ramping up pediatric facilities and hospitals.
There's already talk of a deadly and dreaded third wave.
Bharat himmat haarne wala desh nahi hai. Jab Bharat himmat haarega aur na koi Bharatvasi himmat haarega.
Waves in the sea are made up of crests and troughs. While the crest is the highest point and the trough is the lowest, waves are cyclical and are always preceded by a trough. If we compare waves to viruses, the virus should be cyclical, which means if it is active during the winter, the summer is when it spreads the least, and the following winter is the second wave. The theory of epidemic waves was first proposed during the Spanish flu pandemic. At the time, the First World War was raging. Military censorship was used to suppress news in most countries, except in Spain, which did not participate in the war. As a result, the pandemic was named the Spanish flu. But the truth is, we still don't know where the virus came from or how it behaved, and there is no agreement. As a result, appropriating the term waves from Spanish flu and applying to COVID-19 is unscientific.
At the time, it was given the name Spanish flu, but it definitely didn't originate there. The reason for this misnomer was that Spain was a neutral country in the First World War, and therefore it had no reporting restrictions. However, the media of the combatant countries didn't report the disease for fear of damaging morale and affecting the war effort.
Nonetheless, a closer look at the previous 9 epidemics and the current COVID-19 pandemic reveals a critical statistic. 8 of the 10 epidemics were caused by influenza A viruses, while the other 2 caused by coronaviruses such as SARS-CoV-2, SARS-CoV-1. Here, influenza viruses behave in waves similar to seasonal trends, but coronaviruses do not. So the concept of waves may be inapplicable to understand the COVID-19 virus and its progression.
And even though respiratory viruses in the past did tend to do this, you know, different seasonal waves, this one is behaving differently. This one is one we have to be aware is learning about us as we're learning about it.
Harris also warned against thinking in terms of virus waves, saying that instead, it's going to be one big wave.
To our eyes, the coronavirus seems like it is behaving in the pattern of waves, but there is a danger if we fall into that illusion. Sadly, that's what led to a devastating surge of cases in India. For example, if cases are rising, government will enforce lockdown, testing increase, and automatically cases will come down. Then we start unlocking, testing decreases. Less testing means scientists have fewer data to analyze and predict, making the desperate politicians open up the economy completely. Meanwhile, a new strain starts spreading silently. Finally, as the country is fully unlocked, we see the surge of cases. Governments are hesitant to call for another lockdown until it becomes a catastrophe.
We've never really had waves in the sense of up and then down to a good baseline. It's been up and wavering up and down till now we're at the highest baseline we've ever been, which is really quite precarious. So, you know, it's kind of semantics. You want to call it the third wave or an extended first wave. No matter how you look at it, it's not good news.
Experts' opinion about the third wave and threat to children made many to be scared. However, before delving into views of specific experts, it is critical to understand how far children are at risk of symptomatic COVID-19. The immune system is immature in childhood and it naturally produces a high level of interferon. When a virus enters the body, these interferons are produced, stimulating the immune system faster than adults. In addition, children have high level of interleukin-10 an anti-inflammatory cytokine that prevents inflammation. As a result, there are almost no symptoms. Another widely held belief is that more children are becoming ill today than in the past. Here, we should recognize that children are half as likely to get COVID-19 as adults, but severe cases are rare. We didn't find many COVID-19 cases in children in India because we only tested symptomatic patients who were primarily adults and neglected children. However, when India recognized that the double mutant could threaten children, we began monitoring, and as a result, the increase in cases among children. Some experts even predicted the third wave and the danger it would pose to children. Nonetheless, the predictions are not based on reliable scientific evidence. However, by studying the small data which is available, a recent report from the Lancet Commission Task Force that includes pediatric experts from India concludes, quote, based on the available data, there appears to be no substantial evidence to suggest that children would be more affected or would have greater severity due to COVID-19 infection in the anticipated third wave, end quote. The finding found that less than 5% of children need hospitalization, and out of them, the mortality is 2%, and in those, 40% of children had comorbidities. Lastly, there is a growing debate about children's vaccination, but it isn't straightforward as you imagine. For example, if we start vaccinating children and adults at the same time, then we run into under-vaccination of adults in rural areas, and those unvaccinated people may get COVID-19 and give rise to a new variant which can be deadly even for children. But if we first vaccinate adults, we can eliminate the most vulnerable from getting infected and contain mutations, giving the perfect environment to vaccinate children, but we can't predict exactly. Instead, the alternative should be to vaccinate adults and children with comorbidities. In 2020, most of the thinking revolved around containing spread and patient care, but at the end of the year, world recognized the importance of genome sequencing. Since then, UK became the global leader of genome sequencing, followed by the USA and India yet to catch up. If you bring up COVID cases graphs and combine them with genome sequence findings and restrictions around that time, we can find some important answers, so bear with me. In the UK, after initial surge, cases came down below 500. On July 4, UK Prime Minister reopened pubs and restaurants. On July 15, to support the restaurant workers, he announced the Eat Out to Help Out scheme to encourage customers and even paid £10 per meal in August. At the time, even face masks are not necessary. 3 weeks after the program ended, cases rising and the restaurant industry got hit by curfews and restrictions. His intention is to help restaurant workers, but it helped COVID-19 spread, and we call it a wave. On November 15, cases peaked and came down until December, only to discover a new virulent variant of COVID-19 called B1.1.7 Alpha, which caused the enormous surge of cases and panic worldwide. But the world found a new weapon, that is surveillance of COVID-19 genome as much as you can and plan accordingly. The USA learned hard lessons by not ramping up genome sequencing. Following a new variant found in the UK, California began sequencing to determine the spread of the UK variant, and they found it in relatively few samples. Still, to their surprise, they also found a new California variant in January, which some researchers believe exists from July and started spreading in November. The improper genome sequencing made the USA blind, and the synergic effect of the COVID-19 variants devastated the country. But the USA learned the lessons, and now they're sequencing about 25,000 samples per week, which is greater than they did in the entire 2020. After an excellent panic response to the first wave in India, cases came down below 20,000 in January, which is a lot combined with poor population to testing ratio capabilities in India. We thought we saved the world, and our health minister thought we were in the end game. Still, we are complacent in the end game and made blunders by not increasing the surveilling capabilities. And to rub it further, we held election rallies along Kumbh Mela, which made people believe we won the war. To all the people in India, the Delta variant is magic. The second wave is magic. To the scientific community of India, it is a disaster where 200 scientists need to write a letter to PM to get access to ICMR COVID data to study the virus behavior and develop strategies. Some scientists even invested their own resources to study the virus. You see, it is complete disharmony, and limited resources of the scientific community led the way for the deadly variant like Delta, which is also completely visible in the total genome sequences done by India. We did 20,000 in total, and the USA doing all that in a week. By studying these three countries, testing, tracing, and isolation are not enough. We should sequence sample as much as possible, study variants as early as possible, and plan accordingly. The days to let the virus spread and imposing lockdown to control the spread and repeating that cycle should end. We should be proactive than the virus. I did this chapter to combat baseless predictions going around in the media. My views are influenced by all the scholars and scientists. Hello guys, thanks for watching to the end. I'm excited to do more videos like this and bring you the best information available. And so in the way we fight misinformation together. Consider to subscribe if you like what I'm doing. It's free of course, but it's gonna help me a lot and boost my confidence. I'll be back with another video soon. Until then, stay safe and stay awesome.